Welcome all. Thank you for joining me virtually for my talk today. I'm Dr. David Retchless from Texas A&M University at Galveston, Department of Marine and Coastal Environmental Science. My talk today is Cartographic Generalization for Mapping and Coastal Change Hotspots, an Automated Buffer Series on Global Surface Water Data. And I want to give quick credit to my graduate student, Nick Wellbrock, who did a lot of the work on this project as part of his master's thesis. So a bit on the big picture here, what it is we're trying to do with this project. We're looking to identify coastal change hotspots. We define those as areas with the greatest surface water change in terms of aerial percentage. And we're looking at both gain and loss in surface water in these coastal areas. And based on the existing literature, we expect to see these greatest rates of change in semi-enclosed coastal systems like bays and estuaries, and also in river mouths and urbanized coasts. So the problem that Nick and I encountered in trying to better understand where these coastal change hotspots are is how we might best segment coastal waters into regions for comparing changes and finding these hotspots. And given that the literature suggests that the level of enclosure of the waters plays some role here, we wanted to identify hierarchical regions in coastal waters to better define sort of level of enclosure and compare rates of change in surface water gain and loss accordingly. This led us to develop some specific questions and hypotheses. Our first question was, can a hierarchy of embayed, i.e. semi-enclosed coastal waters, be identified using cartographic generalization methods? Second, are changes of coastal surface water concentrated in smaller or larger embayments, more or less enclosed areas? And third, are the observed patterns of surface water change consistent across estuarine and non-estuarine embayments? We hypothesized that coastal waters that are nearer to shore, more enclosed, and more estuarine will be associated with more surface water change. And as a test case for looking at these questions, we considered surface waters in the South Korea area. The data set we used to explore this problem is known as GSW, or Global Surface Water Data Set. It's a 30-meter resolution global surface water change data set as described in Perkal et al. 2016. Landsat-based. Temporal coverage varies with region, but generally there's data available from as far back as 1984 in some areas, including in Korea. And then it runs up through the present. They're constantly updating it. But the version that we used here was current as of 2018. And we used two different products from the GSW, a maximum surface water extent over the period of record, and then also another product that showed transitions in surface water over that period, for example, from permanent to ephemeral, or permanent waters that were lost, or areas where permanent waters were gained, et cetera. And we'll look at some more of those transitions in a bit. So as I've teased a couple of times now, the approach that we decided to use to explore this is based on ideas from cartographic generalization. And as you all are well aware, coasts fractal geometry requires generalization for cartographic representation. And many such generalization methods are based on the identification and elimination of bends in the coastline. And we thought it might be possible to repurpose some of these generalization methods to help us identify these bends, these embayed areas, as we're calling them, and then to segment those waters out and use them to develop a hierarchy of embayments for our areas of interest. Therefore, our criteria in selecting a specific generalization method was we needed something that would minimally alter the coastal geometry. Unlike for cartographic generalization purposes, we weren't really interested in simplifying the geometry itself, but instead just finding those bends. We also only wanted to find the exterior bends, those facing the water. And we wanted to have a method that we could use to create, as I've said, a set of nested regions, that hierarchy of embayments. And this led us actually quite a ways into the past, all the way back to work done by Perkal 1966. And they theorized that you could roll a circle along the coast, and the diameter of the rolling circle would determine the level of generalization obtained. So if you roll a smaller circle, the result is a bit less generalized. The larger circle gives you a more generalized result. Several authors have picked up on this and extended it. One of the most recent being Mitropoulos, 2005, and they found a way to implement the rolling circle method using a series of buffers instead of directly modeling the rolling circle. And they also used the results of their iterative buffer series to create a hierarchy of coastal waters, as we were interested in doing for this project. So it seemed a pretty good fit. And you can see sort of the tree structure that they derived for coastal waters, for their example, an island in Greece. And this produces a result that is an embayment hierarchy result that's actually analogous to classic stream water. So with that method in hand, we set about developing some tools. First of all, we had to obtain our global surface water data. For that, we use Google Earth Engine. There's an interface set up to access and download that GSW data set, which again is global in scope. And so Earth Engine is a really nice tool for getting at pieces of that. And so this is what that global surface water raster looks like for South Korea. When you pull it in, it extends a good ways offshore, but doesn't include areas, you know, the deep ocean. We took that and vectorized it, cut it down a bit just to our area of interest, namely South Korea, removed some of the inland waters, et cetera, and then exported that into ARC, where we ran a series of tools developed in Model Builder. The first of these identified separate land masses, since the iterative buffer method requires working with just one land mass at a time. And so this tool, as you can see, separates mainland South Korea from some of the nearby islands, and then each is treated separately with the remainder of the method. Next, we used a coastal feature identification and delineation tool. And this is really the core of the method, where the iterative buffer is applied that identifies those embayed waters as defined by the given buffer size. And so we start with sort of a donut polygon with the geometry for the landmass of interest erased from the middle, apply a negative buffer to that, and then a positive buffer of that same value is applied to the negative buffered polygon. And then that resulting polygon is erased from the original polygon on the far left. And that leaves us with the embayments defined by that buffer size. That's then repeated for each of the landmasses in your area of interest, and you get something a bit like what you see on the right. Again, in this case, for South Korea. It's also repeated for all of the buffer sizes of interest. For this initial case study, we used 3 buffer sizes derived more or less through trial and error. I'll say more about that at the very end of the talk. We used 2.5 kilometers, 5 kilometers, and 25 kilometers. And as I've said a couple of times, and as established by Mitropoulos, these buffer series nest within each other. And so here's an example for Asan Bay in South Korea with the 5 kilometer and 25 kilometer buffer. You can see that there are several 5 kilometer buffer polygons that nest within a single 25 kilometer buffer that covers most of the Asan Bay area. Finally, for some of these, since we were interested in whether or not these embayed areas could be considered estuarine, we also did an intersect with a stream data set to see if there was freshwater input to these embayed areas. With these polygons in hand for multiple buffer sizes, we then proceeded with our coastal surface water change analysis process, as we called it. This is an extract by mask operation where we use the polygons derived for the various buffer sizes as our masks, and we use that to extract the surface water from the surface water transition raster data that will give us information on the surface water transitions just within the embayments identified by the buffers of that size. And so again, to focus in on the Asan Bay area in South Korea, this is what that looks like. You get a sense of within the area defined by that buffer size polygon, different kinds of transitions, areas that remain permanent water throughout, areas where permanent water was lost, seasonal water was lost, in some cases, areas where permanent water was gained, et cetera. Finally, we analyzed these results. The methods here considered both changes locally on an embayment by embayment basis and also an aggregate for all of South Korea. We looked at the different surface water transition categories, both separately and together. In particular, we grouped those involving gain and loss and used that to come up with overall percentages of each of our polygons for the embayed areas that exhibited gain or loss of surface water. So we could come up with overall assessments of surface water change in each of our embayed areas. And so, these were our results at the national level with the 25 kilometer buffer. These are just the estuarine embayments, and we're looking at net surface water coverage change. And the cool colors show areas where there was actually a gain in surface water coverage. The warmer colors show a loss in surface water coverage. And you can see just sort of at a glance here that most of the estuarine embayments did exhibit more loss of surface water than gain of surface water in South Korea. This was borne out by our numerical analysis. Again, looking countrywide, we saw that on average, across all of our embayments, regardless of buffer size or whether or not they were considered estuarine, we had somewhere between 3.5% to 6.5% loss of surface water coverage. We did see a higher percentage loss of surface water if the embayment was estuarine, had some freshwater input, or if it was generated by a smaller buffer size. So in general, our 2.5 kilometer buffers or 5 kilometer buffers had higher percentage change, and more specifically higher percentage loss in surface water as compared to looking at the 25 kilometer buffers. And so this was consistent with our hypothesis that we'd see more change in areas closer to shore or more enclosed. Also qualitatively, we noticed that we saw more surface water loss in areas associated with urban or agriculture. And that's not unexpected since land reclamation is ongoing in many parts of Korea, as are expansions of agricultural areas. The last thing to note here is that a larger buffer was needed to capture the maximum loss in estuarine versus non-estuarine embayed surface water. So you can see over here, our surface water loss was maximized at 5 kilometers in estuarine areas and 2.5 kilometers in areas that were just embayed but not estuarine, suggesting that in those estuarine systems, change is perhaps extending or pushing a little bit further out into the water, further out into the embayments. So in conclusion, we did show that our methods from cartographic generalization can be used to produce a nested hierarchy of embayed coastal waters. And we generally confirmed our hypotheses regarding where we would find these hot spots for surface water loss and change. And looking forward, it appears that this method could be useful in other contexts where regions are needed for monitoring of coastal environmental change or health. And to that end, we're looking at refining this method. We want a more comprehensive set of buffer sizes. And so here's a preview of that, what that might look like. We're looking at possibly a geometric series of buffer sizes. We want to be more rigorous in terms of how we define how far inland to go with our surface water for the assessment. So now we're looking at using tidal data, tidal range to establish that, as opposed to an arbitrary distance from the coast. And that's been implemented in what you see here in this figure. On the seaward side, we're looking at using seaward extents defined actually based on the buffer geometry itself. It so happens that particularly in headland areas where you have small embayments, once you get past a certain buffer size, geometry doesn't extend further out from the coast, but instead begins to go pull back in towards the coast. So you get cases like what you see here, where the largest buffer size is not the 256, but instead the 128 kilometer buffer, even the 16 kilometer buffer. And as we refine these methods, we're looking to eventually apply this process to other countries, and maybe even globally, to develop a product that others can use for similar analyses of coastal change. Here are my references. I'm happy to share these on request or via the Slack. And I would also welcome any questions. Thank you very much.